Zdravo svima ljudi, dobrodošli. Sa nama je danas Lazar Bulatović, on će govoriti o, on je zapravo accessibility, radi website za konsultovanje i to. Govorit će danas nešto više na svoju temu. Izvoli Lazare, predstavi se.
Hvala. Dakle, da, kao što je koleginica najavila, ja pomažem kompanijama da... As your colleague announced, I do help companies to make their websites friendly towards people with disabilities. Imagine being thirsty in the desert, and suddenly you see a glass with fresh water. However, the glass is placed too high, and you cannot reach it. This is how people with disabilities feel when they want to buy something on the web or use a product on the website that is not accessible. And you know what? Making the website more accessible is not really hard. Sometimes you just need a couple of kind words and a slight threat. A few years ago, I was looking for a job, which luckily is not the case at the moment. I found a position suitable for me. The position has been advertised on one of the leading job searching platforms in the region. However, the problem was that even I wasn't qualified to apply. For blind people, it was not possible because uploading the CV was not accessible for screen reader users on that platform. I gave them a call and said, "Hello, this is Lazar from Belgrade. I tried to apply on your platform for XYZ position. However, it's simply not accessible to screen reader users." A young lady said, "Oh, I'm so sorry about it. Let me transfer you to our technical support agent." And then they responded. I explained the circumstances and they said, "Excuse me, but what is the assistive technology tool you're using?" I said, "A screen reader named NVDA." "Interesting. Let us check and we'll get back to you." And they did. A few minutes later, I got a phone call and he said, "You are perfectly right. Our platform is not accessible to blind or visually impaired people. Unfortunately, we cannot fix it at the moment because improving this section would require ceasing our operations for a couple of days and basically shutting down the platform for some time." And I said, "All right, but how can I apply for that position?" He said, "Look, I'm going to leave you my email address, and every time you need to apply, just send me the documents and I'll put them in the system for you." "Okay, but what if I want to apply 10 minutes before deadline?" A couple of years later, I got a phone call. On the line, there was my friend. "Hey there, you know what? I'm going to look for a job. Do you know if the XYZ platform is accessible?" He was blind by chance. I mean, he is. I don't think he can see at the moment. And I said, "Well, I'm not sure. Let me double check." It wasn't. Guess what? It wasn't. Still. I gave them a call, and I said basically the same thing, and asked for the reasons for which the issue was not resolved. And he said, "You know what? Yes, but the problem is that we had COVID crisis, and then we had to restructure our budget. And so that's why." And I said, "Look, if you do not resolve this issue in the soonest time possible, I'm going to publish this on LinkedIn and tag you in the post. Do you really think that people would be happy to know that a platform is not available to the underemployed population?" It was Friday when I gave them the call. I checked the platform on Monday and everything worked as expected. So yeah, accessibility can be done. Well, let's see how you can discover if your website is accessible or not, and recognize some common or possible accessibility issues. This is the first step. Second step is discussing this, those issues, and importance of accessibility with your team. Now, remember this. If you want to achieve full accessibility, your website needs to be available to all people, regardless of disabilities. But today, let's focus on the blind and visually impaired population. Simply because more than 80% of accessibility issues affect those users. But before coming to that, I want to ask you a question. Maybe we'll have some volunteers or people who know this. Do you know how do blind navigate the web and how do they use devices? If anyone can raise the hand and well, yes, exactly. Exactly.
Oh, wait a second. What did you say?
Screen reader.
Yeah. That magic word.
Yeah.
Screen reader.
Cool. So exactly. Blind people use devices with the screen reader. The screen reader is a speech software that converts text into speech. Screen readers are available to iOS, Android, Windows, and Linux operating systems. Now, for PCs or for Windows, let's focus on Windows. Blind people usually, in most cases, use only keyboard. However, along with standard Windows commands like copy and paste, they need to remember hundreds of keyboard shortcuts that are exclusively related to screen reader. We call it screen reader users only. For example, if you have a Chrome opened and the website, and then the screen reader is turned on, and then if you press Insert plus F7, the list of links will open, allowing blind people to navigate easily. Now, if you want the website to be accessible, the website needs to conform to certain accessibility standards. Mostly to WCAG, Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. Now, WCAG actually tells how the website should behave in different situations, in different circumstances. So basically, WCAG prescribes a lot of rules. If the case is X, the website should behave Y. And now, let's see what are some common accessibility issues according to the WCAG, and how you can know that your website is actually in accordance to the WCAG. So first of all, headings. Your headings should be placed in a logical order. In many cases, when I do testing, I see a lot of headings placed illogically. H5, H3, H2, and then H1. Or even sometimes pages do not have H1. That is perfectly wrong. Videos. For videos, there are a couple of things you need to know. Your videos must be accessible not only to the blind, but also to the deaf users. Here's how to do it. In videos, include captions. So whenever something says something, this must be conveyed through the text, and also other signs and hints, like applauses, laughs, whatever. This is very important for deaf people, so they know what is going on. If you want to make your video available to the blind, there are two ways to achieve this. The first way is to include audio descriptions. This requires some effort and time, and it is more expensive than our second way that we are going to discuss shortly. But overall, audio descriptions need to be created and done by the special agency that has experience doing that. Also, they need to be very precise, but not go over in details, because they only need to tell people if, you know, they need to convey events that are actually important for the video. And this is very difficult for, let's say, ordinary people to identify what those events are. So that's why they outsource this work to some special agencies. However, what is also important is that audio descriptions must be able to be turned off or on depending on the desire. So way number two is include transcriptions. That is much more cost-effective solution, and blind people can scroll through the text easily. Also, they need to be able to get turned off or on as the user wants. Images. Whenever you have an image conveying important information, this must be reported to the screen reader user. How? Well, you can include alt text, but what if the image contains some elements that are too complicated or that cannot be put into the alt text? A few things you can do. You can place that text beyond the image, or you can include so-called screen reader text only, describing the context and the information that image gives. Okay. But if the image does not convey important information, if the image is a decorative one, then you need to give it alt text zero, so empty attribute. Why? Well, because in that case, screen reader will skip it, which won't make any confusion for blind and visually impaired people. If the table or if there is a graph containing important information, you need to make this graph as a text. Basically, you have to adjust it accordingly. Now let's go to carousels. Carousels are very interesting. Please include instructions for screen reader users. So before the carousel, there must be an instruction saying, hey, you're coming to the carousel. Previous and next buttons are labeled. You are labeled correctly. You can use those buttons to move through the slides. Also, next and previous buttons must be properly labeled. If the slide contains important information, please include ARIA current so people know what is the slide currently being displayed. If the slide rotates automatically, which we are going to see very shortly, this is, you know, very, very critical issue, please either avoid using those carousels with automatic rotations or include pause button. So screen reader users can pause that very, very disturbing thing for them. Auto-completes or auto-forms, imagine you have a form, a contact form, with four fields. First name, last name, email address, and message. Now, if the fields are required, this must be conveyed to screen reader users. In this case, let's assume that first name, last name, and email fields are required. Now, imagine a person typing a message, but forgets to complete the first name. They click on submit, and according to the standard, here is what should happen. An error must be reported, and the focus, remember this, the focus must be moved to the field that is currently required, but that is not, left empty. Okay. And also, if the message is sent successfully, this should be conveyed to screen reader users as well. Let's go to searches. Please include instructions for them. If the results appear as they type, when the user types, this must be also told to screen reader users. And the fields need to contain instructions saying, like, hey, please use your up and down arrow keys to navigate the results and enter to select. Radio buttons and checkboxes needs to have fill sets and legend. Also, give them grouping rule. Then, drop-down menus, please use the native drop-down menus. Do not try to customize them, as sometimes they require further further solutions. Expandable buttons and expandable menus. If the buttons, if the menu expands on a button, this must be conveyed to screen users. So include ARIA expanded control, so they know whether the content is expanded, collapsed. The content that functions as a list must be indicated as such. Text that functions as a heading needs to be marked up as a heading. Now, I would kindly ask my assistants to play the video that I have prepared so you can see inaccessibility in practice. After this, I'll let you know how you can check the website accessibility in less than 30 minutes.
This meeting.
All right, so now I will show you two inaccessible websites. When I say inaccessible, I mean unavailable for blind people and screen reader users. You will be able to experience what it looks like when you're blind and you want to get something, get the information, or book something, buy something from the website which is not accessible. Let's start with eDreams. For people who don't know, eDreams is the agency that allows you to book flights. So now I have this website up and running. Let me maximize the window so you can see it properly.
System menu, your travel agent.
I will now press E key.
Where from, edit.
Where from. I'll press enter.
Where from, edit land.
And let's say I want to fly from Belgrade.
B-E-L-G-R-A-D-E.
Okay. I will now press tab key.
Belgrade, where to, edit land.
Where to. Let's go to Athens.
A-T-H-E-N-S.
Okay. I'll now press escape key to leave this edit field.
List with six items at Athens. Greece. Volnian Chylos, Volos, 164 km from Athens, Kefisia. On Athens. One Volnian, Greece, at Athens.
Okay, I can choose the airport.
Greece, Volnian 100 on Athens, United States. Ado Athens, in on 100 Volnian, Greece. Volnian, Greece, at Athens. Out of list land, where to, edit at departure, edit red only. Where to, edit Athens.
Okay, so I think I'm able to choose, I was able to choose the airport.
Departure, edit red only.
But now I have to choose my departure date. I'll press enter here, but I already know that this won't be accessible because this is the red only field. And when you encounter this on a calendar, it's very difficult to do anything.
Your travel agency, book cheap flights, eDreams.
Okay, so now I opened this field and now I'm going with my down arrow key, so below the picker, then to the left. I press my left arrow key, then I'll press my right arrow key, up, and it doesn't say a word. So it is not possible to pick the departure date. Let's go, let's see if I can choose the date, the return date.
Continue button. Return edit red only. Your travel
return again. So I can't choose my return flight. Okay. So the date picker is not accessible, and people with disabilities, particularly blind people, are simply not able to book the flight throughout this agency. What a pity. Now, let's go to the other website. It is Tesco Supermarket. It is the, as far as I know, one of the biggest supermarket chains in the UK.
Out Tesco Supermarket's online growth.
Okay, so now I'm on the website. I'll press
system menu. What's
Alt space and X to maximize the window, and then I will go down the page.
Link skip to main content.
Right,
community food connection team we're working with Fair Share to save and donate surplus food from our stores. Find out more. Community food connection team we're working with Fair
but
Share to save and donate surplus food from our stores. Find out more. Community food connection team. Find out more. Viewing three of three items. Link skip to footer. What's for lunch?
You see, this is the slider that is constantly appearing.
Community food connection team we're working with Fair Share to save and donate surplus food from our stores. Find out more. Community food connection team we're working with Fair Share to speech mode off.
Let me switch off the screen reader. So now the slider is here and it constantly speaks, which simply does not allow me to control my behavior on the website. Let me turn my screen reader again.
Speech mode talk. Out of list dialog, we use cookies to improve your offline. Some functionality may be unavailable. Menu bar, menu item button, sign in. Community food connection scheme, we're working with Fair Share to save and donate surplus food from our stores. Find out more. Community food connection scheme, we're working with Fair Share to save and donate surplus food from our stores. Find out more. Community food connection scheme, find out more. Viewing three of three items. Community food connection scheme, we're working with Fair Share to save and donate surplus food from our stores. Blank. Looking for a change? Mix up mealtimes with our range of covered staples and dinner kits. Shop now. Looking for a change? Mix up mealtimes with our range of covered staples and dinner kits. Shop now. Looking for a change? Viewing one of three items. Looking for a change? Mix up mealtimes. Speech mode off.
Okay, so I think you got the idea what it looks when the website is not accessible.
Meeting.
All right, so now I will show you two inaccessible websites. When I say
please stop the video,
I mean unavailable or blind.
Thanks. So yeah, those are some critical difficulties and issues. But how you can check the website against accessibility? Well, first, you would need some automated testing tool, you know, under assumption that you are not accessibility professionals. You would need some automated testing tool. I won't be promoting any of them. No one pays me to do that. But yeah, you can Google that. Then prepare the web pages to be tested. The tool will give you a report. After this, turn your monitor off. Try to find some screen reader like NVDA, install it, turn it on, and do your best to achieve all things you want to test on the website with the keyboard only, just by listening and just by using the keyboard. Then try to turn the screen reader off and turn your monitor on, and do the same with the keyboard without the screen reader. Because just as something is accessible with the screen reader does not mean that this will be accessible with the keyboard. There are many people with, for example, motoric disabilities who do not use screen reader but use only keyboard. So that's why. Accessible website can help you increase traffic, win more clients, and basically improve your brand reputation. Here are a few ideas on how to achieve this. First, once you're sure that your website is accessible, find a person with disability to record a video and ask them to do the video using your website hassle-free. Promote this further. Also, talk about accessibility in your social media campaigns. Join groups gathering people with disabilities and show how the website is actually friendly towards them. And you know, making the website accessible is actually a transformation from average or even hostile to a disability-friendly place. And I know that we are going to leave soon, but if there is one thing that you should remember after this talk, it would be as follows. Be aware that many websites that you can influence in one way or another are readily available to you, but not to everyone. Try your best to change it. Thank you, and I'm open to your questions.
Yeah, hi. So I have one question regarding accessibility. You mentioned that we should avoid using non-default input options. For example, let's take the select HTML tag. It can be fairly difficult to style with CSS. So often I see that people do implement their own using divs and I guess other elements to simulate a select option. But recently I actually saw a website of ours, I guess project I'm working on, which is not accessible. So what would be a good way to, when we have to not use a native input like select, what are some good ways to make it accessible? I know area label is something which is used often, I believe. What would you suggest in such a situation where we need to sacrifice that for the design?
In that case, you can try to use semantic HTML as much as possible. If you can use, for example, native drop-down menus or anything like that, you can always use the appropriate components. That is perfectly fine. We see a lot of websites using them. However, it is very important to test them. And then once they are tested and once all errors are identified, you would be able to know what they are and fix them accordingly. So you will be able to remediate the steps. I just recommended you not to use the custom ones because in most cases, native dropdowns do not have any accessibility issues, just to make things easier for you.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Someone else?
Yeah, first, just in the previous question, I would highly recommend to use something like Radix UI or some other libraries. So they are already really accessible and then really easy to implement. So you don't need to care about all of the details yourself.
What do you mean?
So there are some libraries that they are multi-platform, that they are already built accessible components, especially for the ones that are really hard to maintain in the native HTML. So like select checkboxes and
got
so
it,
on.
Got it.
Yeah. So Radix, it's a really good one. Mm-hmm. But my question is also related to that. So first, thanks a lot. It was a really good presentation. And I'm really happy that actual accessibility started becoming a big topic now, especially EU got like really good steps after that. So my question is, what me as an engineer or someone that is like related, a designer, should be mostly aware to when building UIs to make them accessible for most of the people? So we know that we have a quite good frameworks nowadays. So we have the WCAG that you said, and they have pretty good tools actually for help testing and so on. They have like browser extensions and so on.
Yeah.
But what should I be aware? So for example, how do I know that when I'm building a component, if I should add some specific area label, or if I should make something in a different way that it will be easier for people with disabilities to use the website?
You have to ask them.
But that's true. But you know that it's not that easy sometimes, right? For most of the people.
Yeah. As I told you, you simply that's why people recommend manual testing with automated tools. Trust me, you cannot be 100% sure that something is accessible in one way or another without having it directly verified by users or people who actually are who might be affected with your solution. What you can do is simply what you're doing. Follow the guidelines, follow the process, and try to test it as much as possible by yourself in case you're not able to reach people with disabilities. But at the moment, you met one. So.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't live in Serbia. If I did, I would definitely call you.
Oh, we can definitely connect on LinkedIn.
Sure. Let's do it. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm sorry I don't have a better answer, but.
Yeah, it's okay. But maybe just to share also that the WCAG website, it has a lot of different tools that you that automate that for you. So it has been a lifesaver, at least for many of my friends.
Yeah, that's why I said the We call it pair testing. So basically automated testing, then the sighted auditor, and then the screen reader auditor. So they basically go over the website and all together can identify the crucial accessibility issues. And this is how it's done properly.
Any more questions? Okay, well, thank you, Lazare. It was
thank you.
Really nice.